nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and
Sorry about that. A very good morning to all of you. Wonderful to see you here this Advent morning. And also for those of you watching, participating from home, and any of you who are visiting with us, a very warm welcome. So Advent Sunday is a special time as we begin a season of anticipation, expectation, and also preparation of our hearts to celebrate the gift of His Son on Christmas Day. But it's also a time to look ahead to Christ's second coming, that He will come again to judge both the living and the dead. And so on this Advent Sunday, we begin by lighting the first candle. And so if I can invite Maurice and Tintin to please come as they light the candle. Okay, thank you. We have a scripture verse to help us with. Psalm 33, verse 20, if we can say this together. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. Let us pray this prayer together. Eternal God, as we await the coming of our Savior, give us the courage to hope. Give us grace to see your plans of redemption for our lives, for this community and for the world, through Jesus Christ, the source of our redemption and hope. Amen. Amen. Would you please stand as we begin in praise to the Lord? Come, thou long expected Jesus.
Oh, to send thy being of free. Brothers and sisters, we have come together as the family of God in our Father's presence to offer him praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive his holy word, to bring before him the needs of the world, to ask his forgiveness of our sins, and to seek his grace, that through his Son, Jesus Christ, we may give ourselves to his service. Now, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I'd like to ask you to sit or kneel, as you will, as we come before the Almighty God to confess and repent of our sins. Together, let us confess our sins to Almighty God. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen.
Receive God's grace and his forgiveness. May Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Together we continue to pray the collect for the first Advent today. Let's pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and to put on the armor of light, now in the time of this mortal life, in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to us in great humility, so that on that day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal through him who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the first reading by our sister Dolly.
The first scripture reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 through 7. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the tramping warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Would you please stand for the reading of the Gospel? The Gospel according to Mark chapter 13, and beginning at verse 24. God's people says, "Glory to Christ our Savior." Mark chapter 13, verses 24 to 37. The words of Jesus. "But in those days after that tribulation, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or when the rooster crows, or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. And what I say to you, I say to all. Stay awake." This is the gospel of Christ. Praise to Christ our Lord. Would you please be seated? So on this first Sunday in Advent, we have Benjamin Williams to bring us God's word. And for Advent, the color is purple. And so he's aptly dressed in a purplish shirt. So we welcome him.
I thought Vika won't notice. Very good morning to all of you. I was just telling Vika that no matter how often you speak publicly, you know, when you have to give a sermon, you're a bit nervous. Let me just get my slides. Okay, very good morning to all of you. This is, of course, the first Sunday in Advent, and I think all of us are excited. We are getting into the spirit of Christmas. So today, Vika asked me to speak on the Advent as we look forward to the celebration of the birthday of the King. And I'm also looking forward to it. Oops. Okay. So today, you know, I often do public speaking, so, you know, it's my habit to set out what I want to talk about. So, you know, first of all, I want to spend a bit of time on the introduction. And then, coming of the King, the return of the King, the coming of the King again, and then the birthday of the King. So, let me get going with the introduction. I don't know whether many of you read the Straits Times and the Sunday Times, but a couple of weeks ago, in the Sunday Time, I think it was either last week or the week before that, there was an article in the middle section, and it was prominently headlined, "Why Are We So Obsessed with Saving Christmas?" Did any of you see that article? Why are you so obsessed with saving Christmas? So let's think about it as we commit this time to the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you and praise you for being our Father, for sending your Son Jesus Christ, that first coming 2,000 years ago, and then of giving us that promise of that return, Lord. So, Father, as we look at your word and as we think about the season of Advent, help us to focus our minds on you. So, Father, I pray you bless these words, the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts, that indeed it will be pleasing in your sight and achieve what you intended to achieve, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So this article is really talking about what is happening in the world today. I think all of us, unless, you know, we have hidden ourselves somewhere, know that the world is overwhelmed with the COVID-19 situation. And because of COVID-19, many countries are in lockdown. And in Europe, it was in lockdown, and then, you know, they opened up, and then they had a second wave, and in some countries, a third wave. So this article immediately caught my eyes. It seems that everybody in countries like the US, the UK, France, Germany, and what we call the Christian countries, they are very concerned, they are worried that if the country is still in lockdown or a new lockdown is imposed, Christmas will be ruined, right? And that is why this author asked this question, why are we so obsessed with saving Christmas? So the writer goes on to claim that he loves Christmas. But Christmas does not matter. That's his argument. He says that the real impact of Christmas is actually very small. You know, we think that Christmas generates a lot of the economy, but he says that actually Christmas spending and Christmas activities maybe only account for 1 or 2% of the economy, maybe less. Then he says whether or not we open for Christmas, the restaurants, the movie theaters, they are already destroyed. You know, whether you open or close for Christmas is not going to make a difference. Then he goes on to argue that what makes Christmas fun is the gifts, the feasting, the carols, the family gatherings, and the tiny tots with eyes all aglow. You know where that comes from, right? So his argument is that these things will continue. So, you know, we don't have to worry about those aspects of Christmas. Christmas will still be fun. So the question really is, he feels that what indeed makes Christmas important, politically and socially important, is that it produces an outburst of happiness. Christmas season normally produces an outburst of happiness, of feeling good in your heart. And that's why politicians are very important that we don't shut down for Christmas or we don't ruin Christmas. So it hit me that perhaps in an ironic kind of way, the world was more obsessed with saving Christmas than we as Christians. So I wanted to ask you this question, you know. What do Christians feel about Christmas? Are we concerned? Are we obsessed with saving Christmas? But saving Christmas in the way that we ought to save Christmas. The focus on the true meaning of Christmas, the true understanding of the season, that we ensure that it makes the impact that God wants to make in our lives and in the community. Are we as Christians obsessed with saving Christmas? You know, take it back from the world, the commercialization. So today we begin the Advent season. I don't know whether any of you here have been thinking about what Advent means. In fact, Advent is actually meant to be a very important date in the Christian calendar. Vicar will correct me if I'm wrong. Actually, technically, the beginning of the Christian calendar is Advent, right? This is the beginning of the Christian calendar. This is the beginning of Christian year. And today is the first Sunday in Advent. And the first Sunday in Advent, the message is, anyone knows? Hope. Okay, so traditionally, the period of Advent is four Sundays. Four Sundays before Christmas. And this is a period. And the word Advent is actually coming from the Latin word coming. Advent refers to the coming of Jesus into the world. And normally, normally what is meant in Advent is for Christians to use. We are supposed to use these 4 weeks in Advent to prepare ourselves, to prepare and remember and focus on the meaning of Christmas. And Advent often marks also the period where we become very busy, including in the church. You know, the decorations go up and it's so beautiful to see all the decorations in the church. And then we begin to prepare for our Christmas celebration. So for us, we started early this year because we had to do recording. We have been busy preparing for the birthday of the King celebrations, and I will talk a bit about it later as well. And I think as well as Leon. But unfortunately, in many ways, Advent also coincides with when the world and the commercialization of Christmas begins, right? This is when we see the streets, the department stores, the malls coming up with all the decorations and the bright lights, the glitzy lights. And even in this COVID-19 situation, we find that the lights are out, Orchard Road being no exception. So Christmas sales go into full swing, and soon the Christmas parties will also start. But let me put this thought before you. Whether it is the church preparing for Christmas, you know, in terms of decorations and, you know, the Christmas celebrations, or whether the world is preparing for Christmas, is this what Advent is all about? So today I wanted to focus on how I think we as Christians need to even think about Advent and how we need to respond to this Advent. So Advent comes in, can I have the slide? Yeah. Advent, I want to talk about three dimensions of Advent. So Advent, first of all, is a looking back. Traditionally, normally the first 2 weeks of Advent, we look back on the first coming of Jesus. Jesus coming as the Savior, the Messiah. Secondly, Advent is about looking forward, as Vika said, looking forward to the second coming in glory and power, in authority as a judge, not as a small baby. Now, the third, I think, is something that we seldom think about, the third coming, the coming of the King into our hearts, a personal Savior. So I think Advent must be complete in these three dimensions. Now, if we talk about these three dimensions, I wanted to share about certain aspects of Advent which I think we need to bear in mind. So let me first talk about the two parts of Advent, the looking back into the first coming and the looking forward. There are some common features of Advent, of this coming, I mean. So I talk about the first coming as the coming of the King. The second, the return of the King. You know, those of you who are fans of the movie, you know what I'm referring to, the return of the King in glory. The first aspect of both the first coming and the second coming is that it was not unannounced. I think some of the English teachers in the audience will tell me you should not use double negative, but it is not unannounced. Everyone, Jesus did not come into the world unannounced. The Bible is full of prophecies concerning the first coming of the Messiah. From Genesis, the first book of the Old Testament, to Malachi, the last book of the Old Testament, the Bible talks about the coming of the Messiah. I did not count it myself, so I mea culpa. This, looking at the internet, I came across many articles that says that there are at least 300 mention of Jesus coming in the Old Testament. Perhaps there's more. So in fact, from the beginning, at the very beginning of the story of mankind, in Genesis chapter 3, God speaking to the serpent says, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, between your offspring and hers. He will crush your head and you will strike his heel." A prophecy concerning the death of Jesus and the saving work of Jesus. So right from the beginning, the line was drawn. The Messiah King was coming. And then throughout Scripture, you will read in Isaiah chapter 7, it says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will call him Emmanuel." Very, all of us know this. Today's reading, Isaiah chapter 9, you know, the prophet talks about the Lord Jesus Christ coming from the line of David to secure the David's throne. "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign." Sorry. "He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing it with justice to accomplish this." And then the final two verses of Malachi. You all know what the final two verses of Malachi refers to? The final two verses of Malachi looks forward to the coming of Jesus. Talks about the prophecy concerning John the Baptist, the coming of Elijah. So you see, throughout the Old Testament, people knew that, or people should have known that Jesus was coming. So it was not unannounced. So likewise, the return of the king is also not unannounced. Throughout the New Testament, Jesus repeats this prophecy that he will be back as king. In Mark chapter 13 that we read today, it says, "But in those days, after the suffering, after the tribulations, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers of heaven will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory." Now, this is repeated time and again. And it is repeated by Paul in the epistles and the other epistle writers as well, always encouraging the believers to look forward to the coming of the Lord. So it's not unannounced. In fact, what is the last verse of the Bible? The last verse of the Bible, writer says, "Yes, I am coming quickly." And the believer's response is, what? "Come, Lord Jesus." Right? So it's so powerful. You see, the whole scripture is laid out about the coming of the king and then the return of the king. But why is it important that I want to make this point in Advent, that we should remember this, that of this fact that the coming and the return of the king is not unannounced? You see, despite the scriptures being full of it, and the Jews knew their Old Testament, right from the time they were kids, they had to learn the Torah and the prophets. But yet, when Jesus came, they missed it. Right? Scripture says they did not know the time of their visitation. You see, the danger is, if we are not careful, we may also miss the second coming. Or we may miss it in the sense that, you know, we are doing our own thing and then we forget that Jesus is coming again. So I think it is very important that we remember this, that the coming of Jesus was not unannounced. Number two is that it is sure, it is certain. The return of the king is sure and certain. We can look forward to it with great expectation. It will come to pass. If the Old Testament prophecies turned out true, we can be confident that the New Testament prophecies will also come to pass. You see, the second coming or his return has also been prophesied repeatedly by Jesus, by the epistle writers, as I said. We can be sure that his return will come about. Why we need to be careful? Because even in those days, Peter was already warning the believers. What did Peter warn the believers concerning? He says in 1 Peter 3:3, "Above all, you must understand, in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, 'Where is this coming he promised? ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. Now, you may say that, you know, this doesn't apply to us, but you think about it. What Peter was saying is that people were saying, every day, the next day is the same. You know, we don't have to worry, you know. As it was, it will be, you know, life will go on. We don't have to worry about the second coming. So, Peter warned, this warning I think is very true of us living in this age. We can be so taken up with the day-to-day things. We say, okay, you know, my grandfather lived, my father lived, I live, and, you know, my children will live, and life will go on as per normal. But Peter says, don't be like the scoffers. The second coming is sure, is certain. My third point is that what is common in the first coming and in the second coming is that it involves a message of hope. The coming of the king was about a message of hope. Today's reading in Isaiah, the prophet talks about a people living and walking in darkness. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, light has shone. You know, juxtaposed against the prophecies concerning the coming of the Messiah in the Old Testament, juxtaposed against the message of hope of the Messiah was the falling of Israel. You know, time and again, they failed the Lord. Time and again, there were stories of despair. There were stories of defeat, of exile into Egypt, of slavery in Egypt, wandering in the wilderness for 40 years. Then after coming out of the wilderness, there were periods of wars, attacked by the enemies, led by terrible kings who led them astray, gone into exile, and then, as if damning most of all, in Scripture it says, there were periods where the people of God did not hear from God. Desolation and despair. So it was in the midst of this that the Lord Jesus Christ came. But the hope of 4,000 years, 4,000 years is the recorded history of the Old Testament, could be longer because we don't know how long between the creation and Abraham. But the hope of 4,000 years was the coming of the promised Messiah. The coming Messiah was the message of hope for those walking in darkness. You know, in today's reading in Isaiah chapter 9, it says, you have enlarged the nation, increased their joy. They rejoice before you as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. They were looking forward to the victory and to gain the plunder from the victory, as it were, the benefits from the victory. His return, his second coming, is also a message of hope. The hope of 4,000 years in the Old Testament was the coming of the promised Messiah. The hope of the New Testament is the imminent return of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Mark chapter 13, the scripture that you read, and I will keep going back to this, they say they will see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, the ends of the earth and the ends of heaven. The elect, who are the elect? We are the elect. We are his people. And the promise of the second coming is that all of us will be gathered with the Lord Jesus Christ and share in his reign. So why is this message of hope so important? And I'm emphasizing it because hope is a powerful force. Even Martin Luther King says that, you know, everything that we do comes out of hope. You know, we exist out of hope. We live in a world today which is perhaps equally in darkness as the people of Israel. We face challenges of human existence, physical weakness, men's wickedness towards each other, rebellion and despair. In the same way, the church today can look back at Christ's first coming, his death and his resurrection, the fact that he fulfilled the prophecies, and therefore look forward with eager anticipation to the coming of Christ, and he returns for his people. People need hope when we live in darkness. The hope is in Christ. You know, often hope can be crippled by despair, that feeling that nothing more can be done, no chance of improvement of our lives, little chance of healing family problems, little chance of being healed from illnesses or financial problems. And even Christians, I know many of us would have gone through this same period. Our lives may be a solid rock of faith in Christ. You know, we may be coming to church, we may have lived a life of faith, but at times we are at despair, at a loss, and we don't know why we are going through it. Why is it that God is putting us through this time of despair? But it is okay. It's okay. All of us will go through times of despair. But the hope of eternity is that the Lord is coming back. The Lord is coming back. Don't give up hope. There is reason to believe. The current fallen state of the world cannot be redeemed by any measure of human ingenuity or human innovation. Men can try to do everything. They can come up with the best computer. They can go to the universe, but they cannot solve the problem of the human heart. What we need to do is look forward to the coming, the return of the King, because our hope rests in that. But you see, as we look forward to the coming of the King, both in the first coming and in the second coming, it involves watching and waiting. Watching and waiting. In James, throughout the Old Testament, you know, the prophets warned the people to continue to watch and wait upon the Lord. Whether it was Abraham or Joseph or Moses or Samuel or David, these heroes of the Old Testament, you know, they had to exercise great patience and trust in the Lord, that the Lord will see them through. Repeatedly, this exhortation to be patient, to wait for Christ's return, is repeated in the New Testament. In James chapter 5 and verse 7 and 8, it says, "Therefore, brothers, be patient until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruits of the earth and is patient with it until it receives its early and its late rain. You also must be patient. Strengthen your hearts because the Lord is coming, is near." You see, why is it then important to watch and wait, and to do so with patience and trust? Waiting often meant that God's people had to put their trust in God. He had to give God the benefit of the doubt. You know, we think that God is not in charge sometimes, but waiting involves trusting that God has the matter in hand. His timing is perfect. Biblical waiting is not a passive waiting, you know. It's not like, or it's not idle speculation. And I think it is important for us to remember this, because in waiting, throughout history, people have fallen away while waiting and watching. Or they have decided to inject their own agenda. You have today many prophets who will tell you the end of the world is in 2000. The end of the world is in 2012. Now, this is not new, you know. In fact, I was doing some research on the internet, and apparently, from as early as before 500 AD, there were three prophets in the church who declared that Christ will come back on 500 AD. And of course, you know, it didn't happen. And then in 1000, when the year 1000 came around, people prophesied that Jesus will come back on 1000. But some of it can be even more destructive because, you know, some of you know, the church, the Seventh-day Adventist cult, they started with their leader, William Miller, claiming that Jesus was coming back in 1884, I think. And then when Jesus didn't come back, no, they say, oh, there was a mistake in the calculation, he'll come back in 1924. Of course, Jesus didn't come back in 1924. So too, Joseph Smith, the founder of the Jehovah's Witnesses. So you see, now, you all may not know this little known fact, even Isaac Newton predicted when Jesus will come back. He said he'll come back in 2000. So but why am I saying this? You see, this can be innocent. We can, you know, look at it, laugh about it, and then say, but it can be also distracted because we are distracted. And today, there are many Christians who are distracted because they are obsessed with setting dates and saying Jesus is coming back. And, there are cults that sell everything and say, you know, Jesus is coming back, so, you know, I need to be ready. But that is not the waiting and the watching Jesus is talking about. Jesus is talking about the process of waiting upon Him, becoming more of what God wants us to be. Not waiting and, you know, twiddling your thumb and saying Jesus is coming at 2014 or 2024. No. The waiting is listening to Him, learning from Him, becoming more like what God wants us to be. And that's something that the Jews missed. We should not miss it because we should not be distracted. I better move on quickly. Finally, we need to stay alert and focus. You know, it's very interesting that Moses and Joshua. Now, you know, when Israel went into Egypt, they were still really a large family, a family, but large family. By the time they came out of Israel, they were a nation. Do you all realize that? They were a nation, right? Almost 1 million people, maybe. And their first leaders were Moses and Joshua. Now, I love these two passages, both Moses and then Joshua, even more interesting, is that their last words to the people of Israel were, keep your mind focused on God. I know I'm paraphrasing, of course, huh? But you all go and read the last chapter of Joshua, last couple of chapters of Deuteronomy. In both sort of their final testimony, Moses and Joshua tell the people of Israel, keep your mind focused on God. So why is staying focused important? Because in Isaiah 53, verse 6, it says, or we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord had to lay on him the iniquity of us all. That was the first coming. But in many ways, it is also true now. You see, if we are not watching and waiting and staying focused on God, there's a danger that we will stray. That's why Jesus in Mark chapter 13 says, therefore, keep awake. You do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening or at midnight or at cockcrow or dawn, else he may find you asleep when he comes. So I say to you, keep awake. You see, the Jews missed the coming of the Messiah. We should not likewise be caught not prepared when he appears. So waiting and watching is not passive. It's about listening to God. It's about living the kingdom life. The belief in the return of the King must affect our lives today. You know, we don't go into an igloo or into a cave and wait for the coming of the King. It must affect our life. The fact of the return must lead us to a life of watchfulness, of faithfulness to the Lord, of wisdom, of humility, of activity, of self-restraint, of prayer and abiding in Christ. So I want to move on to the coming of the King. So, you see, often when we think about the first coming and the second coming, we think about it as global events, you know. You know, talk about Jesus coming, you know, Christmas, the Messiah, the Magi coming from Asia. the second coming, you know, he'll come in the clouds, you know, he will gather Armageddon, that sort of thing. But you see, heaven and earth will stand still and watch these events, both the first coming and the seventh. But in a way, the first coming and the second coming would be meaningless if it remained impersonal, distant, and far away. The belief in the first coming and the certainty of the return of the Messiah must lead us to a point of our personal relationship with a personal God. The look back to the first coming, the looking forward to the second coming, must lead us to a point where we want Him to come into our hearts. So I started with this mischievous question, should we be obsessed about saving Christmas? Well, we are. The first step is to enter into a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. I don't know, most of us, I assume, have already given our hearts to the Lord Jesus and have entered into a personal relationship. But maybe we have forgotten, or maybe it has gone cold. But so this Christmas, this Advent, as we start, let's start by opening our hearts and asking Jesus to refresh His presence in our life. So we need to give our hearts to Jesus. So as we give our hearts to Jesus, of course, we need to surrender our lives to Him. We need to give our time to Jesus. We need to spend time with God. We need to talk to God instead of talking to ourselves. So that's part of waiting and watching. We must be ready to give our time in worship. And I included this thing about worship because, you know, it's so difficult to get back the people after COVID-19. It is time to come back. I'm talking to you at home as well. But of course, you know, we hope that we'll have more people soon, or the government will allow more people soon. Then we need to give our time, our talents and our resources. You see, in Mark chapter 13, the scripture that we read is so rich of meaning. There's a part, if you read it too quickly, you'll miss it. It talks about the stewardship, right? It says, when the man went on his journey, he left his home and put his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be warned, watch. Therefore, keep awake. You do not know when the master will come back. So, in a way, who are those that God has left in charge? It is us, right? And when He comes back, we as stewards have to give an account of our stewardship. So, our gifts, our talents, use it for the Lord. And that is very much a part of looking forward to the coming of the King. And then we need to have a compassionate heart. I don't know whether any of you have heard me. You know, I give a lot of interviews on the radio. One of the last interviews was at CNA 93.8, I think. And I talked about someone who had influenced me before in my life, a former boss. And he used to say, you know, Ben, in life, our hearts must be so big that people, an elephant can walk through it. Have you heard this saying? Our heart must be so big that an elephant can walk through it. And of course, when you adopt that as your mantra, right, often people will hurt you. But the point that I'm trying to make is that God calls us to have a compassionate heart. In Matthew, you know, Jesus talks about how when we do it to the least of His brothers, we do it to Him. And I think the only way we can live Matthew chapter 25, verse 35 to 40, you'll go home and read it because, you know, Vika is already looking at me, is that you need to have a big heart. You need to have a big heart. So I want to urge all of you strongly that Jesus wants us to be a giving and an encouraging heart and a compassionate heart even within the church. You know, today there's so many people hurting within the church, and I think this will increase further. As COVID-19 kicks in, you know, people lose their jobs, people will be hurt, there are people going through illnesses, struggling with life. We need to be an encourager. And I must say this, in Thessalonians, the writer Paul says, the Lord will descend from heaven with a shout. That's talking about the second coming, then he didn't say, okay, y'all then better go and get ready, you know, make sure that. He says this, therefore encourage one another with these words. You see, as we prepare for the second coming, it is about reaching out to others, having a compassionate heart. It's about encouraging your brothers and sisters in Christ. That's how we prepare for the second coming. So today, as I close, I want to just remind you that this year we are going to try and put all this into practice by celebrating the birthday of the King on the 19th of December. You know, we can't come together in a big group, but we want all of you to give your heart, you know, reach out to your friends, to your relatives, invite them, have a compassionate heart, you know, invite them to your home, reach out and embrace your neighbor, maybe someone who doesn't know Christ. Come together, open your home. I don't know whether you can invite 5 people or 8 people. Hopefully the government will increase it to 8. And then watch the birthday of the King together. But as you watch the birthday of the King together, remember what I shared with you. The first coming, the second coming, the coming into our hearts is all about a message of hope, of becoming like God, becoming what God wants us to be, and being an ambassador for Christ. So, brothers and sisters, as I close, I want to urge all of you, God, Jesus wants all of us to be faithful to Him, to be His ambassadors, reflecting His love to the world, to those who are around us who are in need. Christmas, let us bring hope to the world. I challenge you this Christmas, this Advent season, to have eyes that are open to those who could use the gentle touch of Christ, of Christ's love in their heart. Jesus ascended into heaven, having given His church the marching orders. You know, in Acts chapter 1, it's a beautiful picture. The apostles are there standing. Jesus ascends into heaven. And then the apostles are staring there, and then 2 angels appear. And they tell them what? What do the angels tell the apostles? Why are you standing there gazing into heaven? Jesus is coming back, so go and get busy. So, you know, our job is not just gaze into heaven. Huh? Our job is to go and get busy. So, brothers and sisters, yes, let's commit ourselves to the Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank You and praise You, Father, for reminding us that You are coming back. And we love You, Lord. We want to look forward to You coming back. But as we look forward to You coming back, help us not to just stand around idle and look into heaven. But Lord, help us to just have You fully in our heart and to share Your love as it overflows from our hearts to those around us. Help us to be Your ambassadors this Advent and this Christmas period. In Jesus' name I pray, Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Ben, for the word. As we have heard the word being preached and released here, we now affirm our faith in the word by reciting the Apostles' Creed. Can I ask you to stand as we affirm our faith in the one true and living God? Together we affirm, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, only Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please sit or kneel as Georgie leads us in the intercession.
Let us sit or kneel in prayer as we come before the Lord. Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you, Lord, for your word to us. Lord, the reminder that you are coming again, that living hope in our hearts and our lives, Lord. And Lord, as we look forward, Lord, we will just not be idling, watching and waiting, Father. But Lord, that our hearts, Lord, will be a challenge and revive, Lord. Lord, to come to have a closer and personal relationship with you, to give our hearts to you, to surrender our lives to you, Lord, that you can use our gifts, our talents for your service to reach out to others, Lord, with a compassionate heart, to be your instrument to encourage and to build others up, Lord, that they too, Lord, may have that living hope in you. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And as we come, Lord, before your throne of grace, with our prayers and our intercessions, Father, we want to pray for your church, Father. Lord, we want to pray that your church, Lord, will be a lighthouse, Lord, to the nations around. We pray for our diocese, Father, and we pray and lift up our Bishop Titus, Father, that, Lord, you will just continue to give him wisdom and strength as he takes on this responsibility, Father, Lord, in leading and guiding your flock, Lord, as the chief shepherd, Lord, of this diocese, Father. Lord, continue to keep him, Lord, and his family in good health and strength. And Lord, we pray for all the clergies as well, Lord, in the various parishes, that you continue, Lord, to use each one of them as your shepherds, Lord, to lead the flock in each of the parishes, Father. Lord, and especially, Lord, we just pray for our vicar, Jeremy E., Lord, and his family, Yiping and family, that you continue to anoint him, Lord, with the power of your Holy Spirit to give him your plans and your vision, your purpose for St. Paul's Church to be a lighthouse to the community around us, Father. So, Father, we just also want to thank you for this. We want to pray for the nations. We thank you for Singapore, Lord, for a good government. We pray for our government, our president, Halimah Yacob, our Prime Minister, Lee Hsien Loong, and Cabinet Ministers, and those in authority over us. We pray that, Lord, you just continue to give them wisdom in leading and guiding this nation in justice and equality. Father, to give them wisdom to implement right decisions and policies, Father, even as, Lord, Lord, open up this nation, Lord, that Lord Singapore will continue to be the Antioch to reach out to the nations around us with your love. We thank you for your protection over this nation and that, Lord, the COVID cases have come down, Father. Indeed, Father, we just ask for your continued hand of protection over this nation, that the infection will be completely eliminated, Father. And Lord, especially pray, Lord, for the situation around us, Lord, and especially in Europe, where we see increasing numbers of COVID cases, Lord, have mercy, Father. Have mercy, Lord, and have grace that, Lord, indeed, that infection will be gone in the name of Jesus. And most of all, Father, that, Lord, the people will cry out to you, Lord, to know that you are the only God, Lord, that can save them, Lord, and save us, Father, from this infection, Father. So, Lord, we just ask for your mercy and your grace that this infection will be down, Father. And, Lord, we just want to pray for our church, for our parish. Especially, Lord, we want to lift up the confirmation candidates, Lord, who are to be confirmed next week, Father, the 25 of them. Father, we just pray for your special anointing of your Holy Spirit upon them, even as you prepare their hearts, Father. Lord, to receive, Lord, the anointing from on high of your Holy Spirit as hands are laid upon them, Lord, by Bishop John Chiu, Father. That, Lord, they will, Lord, be set on fire for you, O God, to continue to be your instrument, Father. Lord, give them wisdom and strength, Father, and that, Lord, they will be mightily used by you, Lord. Lord, as your instrument, Lord. Lord, to go out into the world, Lord, to proclaim the good news of salvation. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity of being able to reach out to our friends, to our relatives. Lord, in this birthday of the King event, We pray, Father, that, Lord, you will just use each one of us, each group, that we will open up our homes, that we invite our friends, invite our neighbors, Lord. Lord, and those who still do not know you, Lord, that they may come, Lord, to just be part of this fellowship event, Father, Lord, and to hear your message, the message of salvation, the message of hope, Lord, this Christmas, in this special event as we celebrate birthday of the King. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And we pray, Lord, for the Angel Tree Project, for many that are going out to the homes, Lord, of the families of those incarcerated, Father, that, Lord, you'll go before them with them, that there will be messengers of your peace, of hope and of love, Father, bringing hope and love to the lives and blessing to the families of these people, that they may know, Lord, that you are a God that loves them, Father, that cares for them. Finally, Father, we just want to pray for those who are sick, who are unwell, home, Father. Lord, we lift up our brother David, Lord. Lord, our brother Shin Yong, Pastor Jason, Lord. Lord, Susan Chua, Lord, and Victor Sia and others, Father. Wi-Fi, Lord, Chin Wi-Fi, that, Lord, you'll just continue to pour your healing all upon them and those that we know who are unwell, Father. That, Lord, you are to know that you are Jehovah Rapha, you are the God that heals, Father, and that even as you continue to strengthen and uphold them, that, Lord, their faith will continue to arise, Lord, and to look to you, Lord. Lord, for you are the God where all things are possible. So strengthen and uphold them. Give them the grace, Lord, each day, Lord, to look to you, Lord. So we thank you and praise you, Father, and we pray and ask all this in Jesus' most precious name. Amen.
Amen. Shall we stand together as the body of Christ as we share the peace with one another? We are the body of Christ. In the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. So we share the peace with one another with non-touch gestures. Can either sit or kneel as we continue in prayer. We pray together the prayer our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the
we
Once again, good morning, everyone. Just a few announcements for you. First and foremost, as Ben has mentioned early on, birthday of the King, and so we have a short video, the last video of the full compilation of the publicity for the birthday of the King. We thank the youth who have put it all together, and so we'll show it right now, and then I will share more. Hey, hi Silas. Okay, come. Come Silas, let's have a seat. Alright, yeah. Yeah, Silas, thanks so much for coming down today and spending a short time to just chat about Christmas and about your own journey. And so just for the benefit of everybody back home, can you care to share a bit about yourself?
So I actually got baptized right here in St. Paul's Church about 2 weeks ago, two or 3 weeks ago on the 11th of October.
Okay.
And as of this year, I'm turning. I'm already 18 years old.
Okay.
So I'll be actually enlisting in the national service in 3 days.
Wow, that's so soon. Okay, yeah. Okay. Well, we wish you well for your national service encounter, and hope you have a good time there. Yeah, and learning new stuff. Let's talk about Christmas. As you know, Christmas all over the world is celebrated, and it's always a time of giving presents, having a good meal, meeting up with family members and friends and things like that. But I think there are many of us out there who don't really understand the actual meaning of Christmas. And I think you and I would know that Christmas is an event where God actually gave the greatest gift to mankind, which is His Son Jesus Christ, to save us all. Yeah. Yeah? And so, with this in mind, Christmas being a time where there's a lot of giving, let me turn things around for you just for a moment. Instead of always we receiving gifts from God, have you ever thought about what it would be like for yourself to give God a gift instead?
That's a good question. For me, I believe time. Because we don't actually give enough time to God.
Right.
And in that time, we actually can appreciate Him, thank Him, and just spend time and talk to Him. That's what I believe. Because in a week, we have 7 days. And though as a Christian who comes to church on Sunday, it's 2 hours the whole entire week. I think we should be able to set aside time mm-hmm. to actually spend more time with Him and be more thankful mm-hmm. and speak to Him more. Because I think the closer we are with Him, the more we talk to Him, our wisdom will definitely increase.
Okay.
And
okay.
It's better.
Okay. Yeah. So you feel that you would love to give God for Christmas a gift this year, which is your personal time.
Yeah, time okay. to Him. Yeah.
Okay. That's a nice gift.
Yeah.
I think it's one of the many things that we can give God. Yeah. So Silas, are you aware that on the 19th of December we're having a Christmas event here in this church?
Yes, I heard about it. Can you tell me more?
Sure, but also let me tell the rest.
Yeah.
So 19th of December, 6 p.m., we're going to have a one-hour program featuring our choir and our Sunday school children, bringing to us some Christmas songs. And of course, not forgetting our youth at St. Paul's Church, they will be putting up a Christmas skit. Now, how you can prepare for the event is firstly, of course, to mark down the date, 19th December, 6 p.m. Invite 5 to 8 friends of yours to come over to your home and have some food ready for them and for yourselves so that you can have some fellowship before 6 p.m. Preferably around 5 o'clock, you get them to come over. And then from there, at 6 o'clock, we will launch the program online and you will get the link where you can join your friends together and watch the program. Now, also, what you can do is spread the word out there to all the St. Paul's Church members who are no longer with us. Maybe they've gone overseas and they're living overseas right now so that they can also join us on this program. So what you can also do is prepare a cake. And at 6 o'clock or maybe after that, what you can do is gather around the cake in your home and sing a birthday song to Jesus and cut the cake and share the cake. But don't forget to take a picture of the cake with the group and send your pictures to the church office so that we can post it up on our website. So don't forget, 19 December, 6 p.m., we'll be live online for all of you all to watch the program. So,
will you be joining us?
Well, I think the video explains everything. I don't have to go into great detail. Yep. So, but we're thankful that we have 13 homes so far who will be opening on the 19th. So please, if you feel led, give me a call, all right? And let me know. Now, the next announcement is a very interesting ministry that's going to be started. It's the gardening ministry. The Christmas services. That's more important first. Hang on, Christmas. Yeah. Christmas Eve service, take note, 24th of December. It's a Thursday, 10:30 p.m. to 12 midnight. And then followed by Christmas Day itself, 25th December, 9 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. And New Year's Day service on the 1st of January, 9 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. All the services will be here, here in the main sanctuary. So just take note of that. It's also on the e-bulletin. The next one, finally, the gardening ministry, something new that's being started. The slides up there. This is by our sister Jenny, and so they're going to conduct gardening outreach training. If you don't have a green thumb and you want a green thumb, this is the way to do it. The dates are 5th, 12th, and 19th December, 9:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. Venue will be Second Sanctuary. There's a registration fee of $10 with materials. The number is up there, and it's also in your e-bulletin. Well, that's all the announcements I have, but our vicar has one more announcement. Over to you.
So friends, next Sunday is confirmation service, and so Bishop John Chu will be here. And you know, we have a combined service, and you know, in previous years, we have to pack this place, bring extra chairs. But because of COVID, we're not able to do that. And so with the 100 limitation, we have to reserve the spaces for the family members of those being confirmed. So we have 24 candidates, each one bring 3, we're already at about 100. So I do appreciate your understanding, so I do apologize. So for next Sunday, most of you will be at home participating in the service, and so there'll be online Holy Communion. And so just for next Sunday, the service, there will not be any registration because we have 24 candidates across the 3 congregations. And so do be praying for the candidates, especially as we continue to disciple them and encourage them to join cell groups if they have not already done so. So the names of the 24 candidates are in your e-bulletin. So please do pray and uphold them to the Lord. So let us stand as we close with God's blessing and go forth. Father, we thank you for your presence with us, that you are God Emmanuel, God with us. Thank you, Lord, for the word today. Thank you for your love poured out through the incarnation, through your the sacrifice of your Son on the cross. Enlarge our hearts, Lord, we pray. Give us big hearts, Lord, that, Lord, we may share your love with others, those who are in need, those who are discouraged, those who have yet to know your saving love. So enlarge our hearts. May our hearts overflow with your love. So we thank you for this season of Advent. May it be, Lord, a season of preparation of our hearts, a season of expectation, but also a season where we especially remember that you're coming again, and that, Lord, may we be ready for you. Pure, holy, living lives that are pleasing in your sight. So may Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you and scatter the darkness from before your path. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Amen. We now have the closing song.
like a bride waiting for her groom. We'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we stand like a bride waiting for her groom. We'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we stand. Even so, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, Lord Jesus, come.
Well, we have come today for our service. We have a blessed week ahead. Please exit the room. Thank you. God bless.
God, we wait, you're coming.